Today is January 18, 2018. This is the meeting of the Kubernetes Special Interest Group. As a reminder, this meeting is public and recorded and published on YouTube. Today, let's move to the agenda. First on the agenda, we have Anthony and Manik, who are going to be talking about libRBD, user mode for libRBD. Are either of you here? Okay, we'll come back to that later in the agenda. Let's move on to the planning spreadsheet. As a reminder, the 1.10 feature freeze is coming up this Monday. This means that we need to declare the features that we are working on for 1.10 before that date. Essentially, what that means is you have to create a feature repo bug associated with your feature and make sure that it is marked for with the 1.10 milestone. So this bug here needs to be updated. For the red blocks here, we need to make sure that a feature repo issue is created, otherwise it won't be tracked properly for this release. So first on our planning spreadsheet is volume scheduling, dynamic provisioning design. Michelle, do you want to give an update on this?
I haven't really started on this yet. I have started because it depends on the topology work. I have started on the topology work and put out a spec update yesterday. So if that can go through and get approved, then I can go ahead and start looking at the dynamic provisioning.
Cool, sounds good to me. Next up, mount propagation. Jan, do you want to talk about this?
I sent a request for feedback yesterday. This feature changes how kubelet works, and it has been tested only on a few distribution and few kernels. So anyone, I ask if anybody uses on propagation in CSI work or for Flex, please send me a feedback. I need to know how it was tested, because without reasonable insurance that it works everywhere, I am afraid I won't approve it for beta, for GA, because it will break things.
Does it actually change default behavior?
Yes, it changes the default from private propagation to slave propagation.
Would it be less risky if it didn't change default behavior?
Yes. Then it would need some reward and it would need to stay in beta for another release. Anyway, so.
Hey, Jen, this is Steve from Rook. For what it's worth, I did test it with Rook and it did work. So Rook has their storage controller in a pod. So this is good. So that.
What OS did you use?
The OS was Ubuntu, I believe.
Ubuntu. Could you send Jan the Ubuntu version? You can turn on everything.
Yeah. Look at this. I will paste the link to the.
I believe on the 6.04 one.
And did you test any large deployment or just one node test that everybody did?
No large deployment, just the regular 2-node cluster, at least for me.
I'm afraid everybody does that. Even that is better than nothing.
Yeah, just a quick question. Is there like an issue that we can add something with what we have tested to it?
Sorry, what kind of issue?
How should we communicate what we
Yeah, well, reply to my message on SIG Storage.
Okay, I will do that.
Thank you.
Jan, if you could post the link to that.
Yeah, I'm looking for it.
Okay. All right, cool. We'll consider that started. Basically, we need much more testing here in order to validate that this is okay to go to beta. It is a dependency for CSI, so if we could get folks with different OSs to try it out and ensure that it works, then we can move it to beta and unblock a dependency for CSI.
I thought this was moving to GA.
No, this is moving to beta.
No, I think it is beta right now.
Oh, it's beta, but you have to enable a feature gate to use it.
Maybe. I don't know. I think it's beta.
Oh, okay. Well, if it's beta, then we're less pressed to get it out because the dependency for CSI is to beta.
Okay. At least if it is beta, it's not on by default because we have to explicitly set feature gate to use it.
Yeah.
I would like to talk more about this, not now, but for Rook, Rook needs this to be on by default.
Yeah.
And CSI does as well. So, okay, yeah. We can take this discussion offline. Next item is block volume support, additional volume plugins, and more tests. Aaron, do you want to give an update?
Yeah, Mr. Hero has put forward a PR proposal for dynamic provisioning of block volumes that's out there. In addition, Scott's working on the AWS plugin. I'm going to start working on the GCE. The Gluster plugin from the CNS team, I heard they're ready for that now to have the proper volume mode into their block provisioner. So those are the ones we'd hoped. Oh, in addition to iSCSI's been merged, so those are the ones we had slated for this release. Yep.
Aaron, who's CNS?
I'm sorry, Gluster, Container Native Storage.
Okay.
They had a block volume provisioner for Gluster prior to this release that did not use these conventions, and they have since updated that plugin. And are pushing
okay,
it
cool.
Hey, Aaron, any plan on doing this for CSI, the CSI plugin as well?
Yes, I contacted Saad, who got me in charge with Vladimir, and that's also on my list of things to do is to update the spec to make sure we have the support in CSI. So that is on my list.
Okay, cool. Thank you.
You're welcome.
Awesome. Thanks. Okay, so next up is enabling kubectl to expose capacity isolation resource management for local ephemeral storage. So exposing this information, Jing, do you want to talk about this?
Not much done yet, but we are like working with monitoring team to see the current like way of support this. So we'll continue to work with them.
Okay, so there's two pieces here. One is exposing via kubectl, and the second is exposing via metrics. Is the status the same for both?
The second one, I mean, we already finished like added in Summer API Prometheus. Okay.
So there's no more work left to be done here.
So for open source, Hipster, we may need to add something in Hipster. Yeah, someone.
This is Hemant here. I was saying that Prometheus thing is like has a bug. Somebody has reported it. That might need to fix. The problem is that even when the pods migrate from the node, the metrics are still emitted. That it is still shows as mounted and user, and that makes the whole matrix confusing. Those metrics should be removed once the pod is no longer running on the node.
Okay. Yeah, I think I kind of remember this. Then I think we can look that bug again.
Yeah.
What's the problem?
Yeah. Come on, can I assign you this item?
Yeah, I am the Prometheus one. I'm looking into it. That bug isn't mine. I'm working on it.
Okay. So it sounds like there's fit and finish work that needs to be done, bugs that need to be closed, as well as heapster work that needs to be done. So we'll keep this item for this quarter. And it sounds like the work itself hasn't started yet, but will soon.
I mean, the second one already started, right?
Okay.
It's just some part of my not finished yet. This first one, like, begin to start, yeah.
Okay. Cool. Next up is the redesign volume reconstruction work.
Yes, so I post a proposal and also actually a PR, the code for it. And so I'm not trying to talk detail about, but anyone interested can comment on that design proposal and also the PR. Yeah.
Yeah, I'm reviewing it. I started looking at it today morning. We should swap the names. I should be the reviewer and Jing should be the one.
Okay. Can you go ahead and do that, please?
Yeah.
Thank you. All right. Sounds good. Next up is improving node failure handling for Cinder. Jing, again.
Oh, right. So there is a PR out for that and I'm reviewing it. So I'm still considering whether it is the best approach. So, but I think so far it seems okay. I will try to work with the owner.
Okay.
And, yeah.
And is there anybody from who else is interested in Cinder willing to take a look at it? Maybe RootFS or someone from Red Hat?
I'm looking at it actually. I reviewed the first PR that the author opened, and I'm reviewing the second PR as well.
Okay, perfect. All right, next up is improve local volume attaching for iSCSI. So we had somebody volunteer this week, Lin Ma, to take on this work. We had a discussion about what this should look like, and Lynn is planning to put together a design doc. Lynn, I don't know if you're on the line and if you want to add anything else. I think Lynn is in China and it's the middle of the night there, so I don't expect him to be here. All right, next up is CSI volume plugin implementation. We are tracking the status of this project in the CSI implementation meeting. You can go there for a detail of what items we're tracking for this quarter. Work has begun. We're going to attempt to move the CSI volume plugin to beta this quarter. Earlier, we were concerned with the amount of work that was required, but what we decided is that we don't need to move every single feature that is part of CSI to beta all at once. We can move the core CSI API to beta and then add on additional features as alpha and move them to beta separately or independently of the core. So this allows us to decouple from things like block support and things like that. So the plan this quarter is to move the core CSI APIs to beta. And then drive on these additional features, for example, block storage support, and you can get the extensive list in that CSI implementation meeting notes.
Asa, just to be clear, when it moved to beta, does that mean that it's going to be on by default, or does the user have to go to add in the feature gate?
I need to double check on that. I forget whether beta features are enabled by default or not. I believe it's up to the developer to decide. If it is up to us to decide, we will enable it by default. But stay tuned for more information on that. We haven't gotten to flipping that flag yet. All right, next up is volume scheduling to beta. Michelle?
Yeah, again, that depends on the topology design. So If the design gets approved, then I can start working on actually moving the code to beta.
Okay. And it looks like the next one is also you.
Yeah, persistent storage, also dependent same. On that, so big okay. dependency chain.
Got it. Next up is local ephemeral storage to beta.
Yeah, so I just plan to work on it, focus on that next week. Yeah.
Okay, cool. Next up, we have volume resizing, Haman.
Yeah, we have not started anything yet. There's a proposal open for online resizing but we are not doing anything in this release actually. We're just letting it basically
okay.
brew for a while.
Should we track anything for this quarter or just cut it for now and then pick it up next quarter if there is actual work to be done?
We are just doing bug fixing for this one. We have So that's it.
But all right. So then I'm just going to remove it from this list for this quarter, and then we can pick it up next quarter when we decide to move to beta.
Okay.
All right. Next up is snapshots to entry alpha. I think Jing has some updates in this area.
Right. So we had a few discussions. In the team, and so we want to push to move snapshots API to entry, but we definitely need some like very strong support and arguments to present to SIG architecture. So because we need approval from them to get it entry, and I'm working on the document and to present. So that we can present to the SIG architecture. And so in this meeting, we'll talk a little bit about something we already discussed, and anyone interested can help us on it too, yeah.
Just to expand on that a little bit, there's two sets of challenges that we're looking at. One is figuring out what the API for restore should look like. So the work that Jing and her team did last couple quarters, she created CRDs to represent snapshots, and then she has a field in the PVC object to restore from a snapshot. And we did an initial API review to attempt to bring that entry, and it looks like folks were happy with the snapshots API, but the approach that we have for restore raised some eyebrows in terms of right now you have to mark the PVC in order to restore a snapshot, and the concern is that you shouldn't have to permanently mark a PVC in order to do what is not a permanent operation. Some of this has to do with the fact that we're working on imperative operations and trying to work them into a declarative API. So we need to work on figuring out the API around the restore operation. Another challenge is thinking about it more holistically. How would higher level primitives like, for example, stateful sets utilize this snapshot and restore ability, specifically the restore? What would a restore operation for a deployments that for a stateful set look like? And then finally, once we have those design questions nailed down, there's the big question about, well, you have this thing working out of tree. Why do you want to bring it in tree into the core Kubernetes code base? As many of you are aware, Kubernetes is becoming more and more extensible and decoupled, and there's a very high bar for what should be part of the core Kubernetes, or what they're calling the nucleus. Our argument largely has to do with the fact that it makes the user experience a little bit easier, and that having this be part of the core will allow higher level primitives to be built on top of it. So that's the argument that Jing is going to try to push for, and then present to the SIG architecture group, and then we'll proceed from there if we get approval. then we can start moving towards pulling this code in tree. If they push back and they don't want it in tree, then we need to consider what the alternatives are and what we can do to make the user experience for out of tree as good as we can.
Just to add, thank you for the explanation.
Uh-huh.
I think that if our proposal was to do in tree before we did CSI, I would really agree with it. But now that we have done CSI and we have three sidecar containers that are outside the tree, and we're probably going to have more, and it's the responsibility of the storage vendors to add this convenience, right, and responsible for these outside components, I'm not really convinced that we need to have snapshots in the tree anymore. There's a lot of components that us as a SIG storage team and the CSI team that we're adding outside it, yeah. And that's becoming more of the norm.
Yeah.
And I just think that we just need to be careful on why is exactly that, that we're adding it.
So. Yeah, and that may well be the path that we go down. I think the big difference between what we have with CSI and what we have today versus having an out-of-tree snapshot controller is that the core logic for understanding the existing operations like provisioning, attaching, mounting, resizing, all these things exist in the core Kubernetes, and Kubernetes understands how to do them natively. The only thing that is extensible through CSI and Flex is the ability to add additional storage providers who support that functionality. And what we would be doing if we keep snapshots out of tree is that we're saying not only do you add additional additional storage vendor functionality out of tree, you add core storage functionality through an external controller as well, which raises the bar for being able to run the storage system, right? You now need to decide whether you want to have snapshotting, then run the snapshot controller and ensure that, the appropriate CSI drivers or whatever that implement that snapshotting ability are also running.
Yeah, but just saying, that's a very engineering view of it, right? As a user, I don't see that. I only see that there's three external containers that I need for my CSI external container, right?
There's still some, because if right now having it out of tree causes some user visible friction. So for example, the way that it's currently implemented, if you want to do a restore operation, you have to have a PVC that is pointing to a special snapshotting provisioner, right? You can't use your standard provisioner because your standard provisioner doesn't understand snapshotting, things like that. But I agree. I think ultimately it will be a very high bar to get it in tree, and we'll let SIG storage or SIG architecture make the call there.
Who's pushing for it to become in tree?
Sorry, what's that?
Who's pushing for it to be in tree? Like, I haven't heard anybody from the SIG storage say, hey, we really want this to be in tree. But there seems to be a push.
I would support pushing it in tree. Snapshot is a pretty fundamental feature of storage itself, right? So why we wouldn't want to support snapshot API as part of a Kubernetes? I just don't see.
Well, it's one of those things that's kind of a vendor specific thing, right?
Like, I really don't think snapshot is a vendor specific thing. Snapshot is I think every storage supports snapshot. It's pretty.
In a
it's
different
like,
place.
The like other one.
It's one of those things that vendors, tend to implement in a specific way that's specific to their storage platform, right?
Well,
and that was
I don't really think snapshot is, well, you could have different policies, but like for example in OpenStack Sender, right? So snapshot feature, this is a required feature from day one. It's just a naturally part of it, right? So I just couldn't think of it as a something has to be out of tree, has not part of the storage itself, right? When you create a volume and you want to take snapshot to protect it, right? So you take some point in time copies of that it's part of that storage itself. It's different from some other more advanced features. Like, you know, if you say, okay, maybe backup, that's a little different. Maybe you back it up in a different device, right? It's a little different. So I think snapshot is a pretty fundamental feature of the storage itself.
I don't know if it's a debate so much as I think most folks agree that it needs to be part of the broader storage interface available in Kubernetes. The questions I have are whether, so it is now because you can use the out of tree functionality, right? So you can snapshot today. The question is, should we make that in tree? So basically baked into Kubernetes and not using CRDs and whatnot. Or like the other question I have is like, or should we wait since Kube is sort of shifting towards more of a CSI interface, like since we've baked snapshot in Kube for a while already with the out of tree interface, shouldn't we push that into CSI and then basically get a some more broader available interface through CSI usable in Kubernetes?
So getting it into CSI is absolutely critical, and that needs to happen sooner or later, whether it's in tree or out of tree, in order to allow storage vendors to be able to implement support for snapshotting. I'm not sure how that would influence the decision of the core controllers that run snapshotting to go in tree or out of tree. I think those two can happen independently.
But CSI is CSI, that's for the, that's for the drivers, right? So it's the storage interface. But for the API, it still does not solve the problem with the API, right? Still, you know, we should add that in CSI. But if we don't add that in tree, your API definition is still not part of Kubernetes. So it's like it's not a core feature.
Yeah, and I think that's an important point, because when you have something that is exposed as part of the core Kubernetes API, then you can have other components of Kubernetes depend and build on top of it, right? So if Snapshot's API exists as part of the core Kubernetes API, then you can start building higher level primitives on top of it. You could have stateful sets, for example, depend on this behavior to build more advanced functionality. I think that's probably the key argument for pulling it in tree.
I wonder if it's an all or nothing type proposal.
The main danger of having it out of tree is that vendors can implement CRDs however they like. And back to Luis's comment about the experience from engineer's point of view, from the user's point of view, this is really about the experience from the operator's point of view, the admins. Imagine if each vendor is going to have their own CRDs with a different format, different structure, different workflow, and now the operators have to, you know, use CRDs in different ways for different vendors. That's the main danger. But as a vendor, yes, it gives us most flexibility if it's out of tree, and we can offer more enhanced services with it. But the main danger is really with the operators.
Yeah, so since it sounds like there is a disagreement about this, let me suggest something. So this quarter, instead of making the goal trying to pull this in tree, let's modify the goal and let's try to remove the friction that exists in the API today and add CSI support for this quarter. And then we can revisit this next quarter, and hopefully we can do a face-to-face meeting around that time, and we can all get in a room and kind of hammer this out there.
Yeah, and I would also request, you know, like we did for the first iteration of snapshots, that whoever is leading this maybe start some community calls where we can hash some of this stuff out.
Yeah.
I kind of feel like some of this stuff's being worked and we don't necessarily all have visibility to it, so we all have questions.
Okay.
Let me ask for a clarification, Saad. So you just said, let's get CSI this quarter. That was already like line 11. Are you just reiterating that, or you're proposing we need snapshot support in CSI this quarter?
So CSI is fun. Kubernetes does not necessarily control CSI. So what this would involve is going to the CSI community, proposing adding snapshots as an extension to the existing calls that are available. If and when that gets merged, then updating the external snapshotting controller to be able to speak CSI. I think regardless of whether we go in tree or out of tree, that is going to be critical for us. The future for volume plugins in Kubernetes is going to be CSI. And so if CSI does not support the ability to do snapshotting, then that means that Kubernetes can't do snapshotting. So I think that we have to do as soon as possible if we ever want to support snapshots.
Thanks.
Hey, I have a question here. So this, since we are talking about entry and out of tree, I thought of asking. So I see a lot of cloud providers, they are still entry, and there are very few out of tree implementations, like DigitalOcean is one thing I remember. So what is the plan for, like, do we have any timelines on when people are supposed to go out of tree? Because I'm from VMware, yeah. And it kind of takes a lot of effort to build something out of tree.
Yeah, so there's a very large effort underway to push all the current cloud providers out of tree. But they're so baked in that it's a multi-quarter effort. There is somebody named Walter Fender who is leading this effort. If you'd like to find out more about it, I can put you in touch with him if you message me offline.
Sure, I'll message you offline. Thank you.
Okay. All right, so let's keep moving. Is everybody okay with the decision to change the goal for snapshots this quarter? Instead of going in tree, we're going to focus on improving the user interface, figuring out the story around restore, getting CSI in, and then we can consider in tree in the future.
Yes.
Okay. So that means that we will not be making any changes to the API itself. It's basically
we can make changes to the API. So for example, I think the API around restore needs to be improved. Okay. So we can continue to make changes to the external implementation that we have. The only change is that we're going to put a pause on our efforts to try to bring it in tree this quarter.
Okay.
The only thing I feel like the discussion of in tree out tree might take long if we don't kind of not working anything now, it's just taking even longer. So I feel at least we start working on something and prepare to present them. When we feel ready, we can present them very soon.
Mm-hmm.
Otherwise,
the longer that we wait, the harder it'll become.
Right.
Well, we should start having calls about this immediately, right, to achieve consensus.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's a good idea. Yeah. I think we haven't talked about this for a long time, and maybe suddenly we discuss about it. I thought everybody in SIG Storage should agree that snapshot should be in tree, but I didn't expect that we are split here. So definitely, I think we should probably have more.
So how about you guys, I'll have Jing and Zhang start the calls offline, and then in our next meeting, you guys can make the call based on the discussions you have about what the next steps are.
Sure.
Okay.
Sure. But for the feature freeze for 110, you said it's the 22nd, right? So that,
it is the 22nd.
Yeah, so that's that. Okay, so that means.
So what we can do is go ahead and create the feature, mark it for 1.10. It's easier to remove the feature than to add it in afterwards. So if in 2 weeks, the decision is that we are not going to push forward with this, it's very easy to pull that feature out. So go ahead and
out of tree anyways, which gives us much more flexibility.
Yeah, out of tree, you can do whatever you want. There's, you know, we're not as aligned with the Kubernetes release cycle, but for the in tree stuff, go ahead and create the feature and then we can pull it out if that's the decision.
Okay, so probably I'll work with Jing to create this first and then we can put it out if we're not ready. Okay.
Yep, and you can send the invite to SIG Storage and whoever's interested can join.
Okay, sure.
All right, cool. Let's keep moving. We are at 20 minutes left in the meeting. Next up is local persistent storage, static pre-provisioner security hardening. Chang, are you on the line to talk about this?
Yeah, so the container identity working group is working on a proposal for per node identity. We're trying to understand the timeline and the scope of that, because the result of that is going to affect what our design is going to turn out to be. So just working with them and figuring out exactly what is happening and how long it's gonna take.
Okay. And if we get a roadmap from them that doesn't align, then we can proceed with this. If not, then we don't need to do any additional work.
Right. We can use the existing design.
Okay. Sounds good. Next up, local persistent storage, raw block support. Michelle.
Both Dharaj and Ian from Salesforce are working on this item.
Okay. So,
yeah.
Cool. So we'll consider it started.
Yeah.
And then block volume support for RBD and iSCSI are already complete. Next up is dynamic volume per node count. We don't have anybody assigned on that. Prevent PVC deletion. Pod is using it. Pavel?
Not started.
Not started, okay. Next up is enable kubectl to expose PVC capacity usage stats. Jing or Chang?
Yeah, we're working with the monitoring team to decide whether or not to represent the metrics as the new PVC metrics as a separate resource,
okay.
Or keep piggyback on existing pod metrics.
Okay.
And after that, the plan is to figure out exactly what. So we had to add new metrics, add the new metrics to the. New component called metric server that they're currently designing. And then through that, we're going to have to expose the metrics to kubectl.
Sounds good. And can we consider this started or not started yet?
Started.
Okay. Prevent PV deletion when it is bound to PVC. Pavel, do you have an update on this?
That is design proposal, and we need someone who has controller knowledge to review the PV controller changes. That has to be me.
Okay.
Look it.
Perfect. All right. Thanks, guys. Next up is encryption of empty dir. Nobody assigned to that, so we're going to skip that. And then volume metrics is being tracked independently. Hamant, any progress on this?
Yeah, we had a bunch of PRs open for volume metrics. I reviewed them. There needs more review, but yeah, we had some people volunteer on the list, so they're making progress.
Okay. Oh, and then finally, flex volume resizing support. Zhao?
Yes, so we have finished the first version of the design and sent it out for you and Chakri's review.
Okay.
And we are discussing this with Chakri. And one more thing is that would you please help to add this ticket to 110 milestone?
Sure, will do.
Okay, thank you.
I will take that offline and let's keep moving down our agenda. After status updates, mount propagation needs more intensive testing. This is an important feature. We need your help with it. Please visit the link that Jan posted here. Otherwise, it may be in jeopardy for this quarter. Next up is PRs that need attention. Jing pasted in about this scalability issue. Jing, do you want to talk about this?
So I think we might have a couple of scalability issues. One we discovered is if the node has, let's say, certain number of pods, let's say 50, and each pod might have, 40 volumes or 50 volumes. So it ends up on each node may have hundreds or even thousands of volumes. And in that case, one is when Kubernetes restarts and the desired state need to loop every volume and get into the state. And that we, in some cases might take a long time, like minutes, tens minutes or even an hour. So we want to collect some data to see whether we do have this scalability issue or not. I think I hit this problem when working with some customer. And we want to have some profiling and collect some data to see whether we can handle, let's say, hundreds or thousands of volumes per node. And if anyone interested in like volunteer this work, I can work with them to do some profiling, collecting data, and see how we can solve this kind of issue. And another one is right now, for each volume operation, we have a separate go routine, and we don't have any limit on how many go routine we can start. In some cases, it might start too many such like process, like separate coroutines, and without any limitation, and it might break down the node to cause the process exhaustion. Yeah.
Okay. So if anybody's interested in helping look into scalability issues, please reach out to Jing. Jing has a lot on her plate, as do many of us. So this is not prioritized very highly for us at the moment. If this is super critical for you, I highly recommend you reach out to Jing and take a look at this issue and see how you can help. Otherwise, we will try to get to it as soon as possible, which may be next quarter. Next up is the new design for volume reconstruction.
Yes, so this new design basically want to find ways to fix the problem we had before, because for some, let's say maybe half of the volume plugins, they cannot construct the volume specs based on just directory, the path information. And the new design is if for those volume plugins that cannot support reconstruction, and we can do the just clean up, clean the mounts directly instead of restruct them into the state. We still want to keep reconstruction because it gives us benefit of, let's say, if your cleanup fails, right? Since it's in the actual state, it can keep trying to unmount and tear down the volume. Otherwise, so we just do it once to clean up. If it fail, I think we have to ignore.
So if the volume, we can discuss this offline, but I reviewed the proposal. I'm reviewing the code, and I'll talk to Jing offline.
Okay. If anybody else is interested in this, please take a look at the design that Jing has put out, as well as the PR, and comment on it and reach out to Jing. All right, next up, let's see, Shyam and Manik. Are either of you here?
So I'm here. I think the right person to talk about it is probably not here. So I put it as a placeholder. I think I'll have him attend the next meeting.
Okay.
Going to talk about it.
Cool. So feel free to move that to the next meeting then. Next up, design reviews, dynamic provisioning for block volumes.
Okay, so, can I go ahead?
Yes, please.
Okay, so this is Mitsuhiro. So, since we currently only support static provisioning for the block volume, we are proposing dynamic provisioning support for the version 1.10. I got some comment from Jan and Michelle, and I'm currently updating the spec. So in basic, this design doc explains how to implement block volume for internal provisioner and external provisioner. So I think there isn't a big change, but one point we need to consider is there is a case that if plugin and provisioner doesn't support block volume, but user can set volume mode as a block. In that case, PV and PVC are created, but they can't be bound and they stuck on the pending status. So I think we need to solve that situation for users. That is the main discussion point. So I'm waiting for the review from Saad and Brad.
Okay, I will take a look at it offline. If anybody else is interested in it, please take a look. And any other discussion on this during the meeting?
No, I think that's all.
Great. Next up is moving snapshots API in tree. I think we've already discussed that at length.
So in the document, the link there, so I add a section list all the reasons why we want to get in tree. And anyone who like has feedback or comments, please put it comment on the document. So there is a section underlying called move into just next page. Yeah, move to into discussion. So those are like our arguments why we want to entry, and we can
okay. On it. So it sounds like the next steps here are there's going to be meetings that are going to be set up in the next within the next week or two. To discuss whether we want to move in tree or not. They will be led by Jing and Zhang, and based on what is decided in those meetings, we will decide whether to proceed with in tree or not, or focus on the other items that are left for snapshots. Next up is postpone PV deletion if it's bound to PVC. John?
Yeah, it's a new proposal open by Nick Ren. He calls himself Nick Ren on GitHub. But anyway, it copies basically the structure of a PVC protection controller, and the main message here is that it's going to be a separate controller. So we will have one controller for PVC protection and second one for PV protection. I hope they will share some code, but just to make it cleaner, we decided to make two controllers. If anybody wants, can review the proposal. But I think I'm going to merge it quite soon.
Okay.
That's it.
Cool.
Any reason why persistent volume controller shouldn't do this?
I would like to keep it separated because the PVC the PV controller is already complicated enough.
I guess where do we draw the line? If every new capability has to be a new controller?
Controller doesn't make a big overhead, I think. The memory is shared with shared informers, and there is just a little, you need to just leave the memory for a queue. And that's it, basically.
So when we talk about a separate controller for entry, it's not actually a separate binary. There's only a single binary for Kube Controller Manager, which has sub controllers inside it that are all running as part of this.
Coroutines with different controllers, and they all share the same API object, so it shouldn't have big impact on the controller.
I think that seems reasonable. Okay, next up, I'm going to jump to Brad's topic, and then we can come back to setting up the one-off onboarding to storage meeting as the last item. Brad, do you want to talk about your item?
Yeah, sure. So there has been increasing pressure from the broader Kubernetes community for us to provide status on a regular basis. And, they've asked, initially they wanted it to be part of the community, the Kubernetes community call that's right after this. And I believe they're moving it to a separate call. I'm not sure. But I kind of wanted to get feedback on what we should be bubbling up as status, what people think's important information that we pass out, And, you know, I have more involvement by the broader group instead of like just me and Saad, you know, going there and rattling off notes from here. Does anybody have feedback on that? Is there things that they, you know, that people feel that it's good in the SIG that we should start bubbling up, or the design topics that we should start giving status on? I'm not even sure what format we'll want to start using, but it's going to become a regular requirement, so we have to
maybe for the next one we can have something, you know, like make sure we focus on something that we actually, our message that we want to provide to them.
That way, do we have to know how the other teams present status in that committee meeting? Haven't been there in a long time. Can we all believe what their expectations are there?
They have, mean outside? Yeah, other teams do present status. And it's a little haphazardly. I mean, like, there isn't like one specific format that everybody follows. But another part of it too is like we have a lot of vocal people in this community. I would hate to see it just be like me and Saad giving status every time. I think there's opportunities for other people, you know.
Yeah, I think so from the community meeting organizers message that we received to the SIG leads, they said one of the challenges that they had was they had to reach out to individual SIGs to schedule them to come in and talk at the community meeting, which becomes a pain for them. And so what they want to do is set up regular or reoccurring time slots twice a quarter for a SIG to come in and give an update. And those would be decided at the beginning of the quarter, which time slots we have. And to Brad's point, you know, me and Brad can always go in and give an update, but it might be a good opportunity for folks in this SIG to get exposure to the broader community and perhaps deliver a more diverse message than you know, what me or Brad can deliver. So for the upcoming community meetings where the SIG storage gets slots to speak, maybe we can have volunteers from this community put together presentations to go and present. Would people be interested in that?
Yeah, I like that idea. I like having volunteers maybe from time to time, having it be more diverse, but deciding on from this call what we plan on messaging to that community. So it's a concise representation of this.
And it could not just be like that one person talking either, like me or Saad to go in there, you know, go over what we have on our feature list and then like hand it off to someone else to go over some other aspect of things.
Yep. Maybe if you could throw out a suggestion of these topics to be presented on, because I imagine a lot of us aren't going to volunteer open-ended on whatever comes along, but if you could focus this on one or two ideas, then maybe volunteers could step up, because I don't have broad enough knowledge to take on anything. It, you know, it has to be something I'm familiar with.
Yeah. And the other thing to keep in mind is that the community meeting always has a slot for something like 15 or 20 minutes in the beginning of the meeting to do a presentation, a demo of anything interesting or cool. There's a lot of cool things that come out of this SIG. And if you're ever interested in broadcasting it more widely, that is an opportunity that is available to you. You can reach out to the community meeting organizers directly or reach out to me and Brad, and we can help set that up as well. You can treat that as an avenue to get wider exposure. And yes, I agree, Steve. I think what we'll do is next time we get a slot to do an update for this SIG, we'll come back to the SIG and we can discuss it here and see what folks want to present and who's interested in presenting.
Sounds good to me.
All right. Aaron, we have 2 minutes left. I apologize for that. Do you want to talk about it now quickly, or do you want to punt it to the next meeting?
I'll just mention, I sent out an email earlier today. Everyone got it on a list of about 15 different topics we feel like would be good onboarding topics. Tried to make it fun and interesting. I am looking for volunteers for each of these topics to plan a presentation that would be recorded and archived for future onboarders. This is to provide mentorship and knowledge transfer within our community to get people able to contribute faster. So please look at that list, and if you feel like you're an expert on that topic and want to contribute to a talk, reply to that email accordingly.
Can you put that link on that document, Saad, please?
Yeah.
And I put it in email. I can probably put it in a Google Doc. I will do that, Vlad. Thank you for the suggestion. That would be
absolutely. Thanks.
And maybe it's in the email, but I confess I didn't see it yet. But on these recordings, would everybody presenting one just record their own and then they get stitched together? Or did you have some idea that these would be recorded at some central meeting?
I think we could offer a meeting if people want, because I honestly think that when people have questions and those are captured in the recording, that's also helpful instead of people having to go to the other again and again and the same questions. So I would like to set up a time for each one of those to record it, and people could come and have that interaction. And I'll schedule it accordingly once I get volunteers.
Okay, thanks.
Awesome. So next steps here are, please take a look at the message that Aaron sent to the Storage SIG group. If you're interested in volunteering to do a presentation, please reply to that. Reach out to Aaron. If you think that there is a topic that may not be covered, especially if you're new to the group and there's something that you really wish was covered, please reply to that email as well and suggest the topic. The goal here is to make sure that folks who are new to the group have the material that they need to be able to get ramped up effectively. So please take a look at that when you get the chance. And that is the last item on the agenda. Is there anything else anybody wants to talk about? All right, then we will call it for today. Thank you very much for your time.
Thanks. All right. Thank you.
Bye. Bye,
everyone.